Namaskar. Welcome from the Indian Cultural Heritage Research, Mr. Jeetu Mishra. Mr. Jeetu Mishra's audience is a very well-known archaeologist, and he has been working outside Orissa but returned with the great victory of the Dongriya Khond over the mining interests of Vedanta, which is a world-famous case of indigenous communities asserting their right. So, Mr. Jeetu Mishra, welcome from the Indian Cultural Heritage Research. And I'm so grateful to you for having accepted this invitation. Looking at the idea of sustainable tourism in the churning of the COVID, especially with regard to the idea of exotica and Dongriya Khonds, they have drawn a lot of public attention. So can you begin by telling me what, apart from this Vedanta, what is so special about their identity?
Dongriya is a community, it's an indigenous community, as we all know, is known for their forest adaptation and indigenous knowledge system. I think that they have these climate change resilience seeds, what they have, you know, they have been practicing for thousands and thousands of years. I think that is the unique aspect about Dongriya Khonds. And that is what I think is worldwide, you know, scientists are drawn to their habitats, and many of them are also going and presenting. So this is what is the specialty about Dongriya Khonds, how they have adapted to the climatic conditions, the mountain adaptations, and the knowledge system they possess, which are some of the key solutions, which were likely to be key solutions, provide key solutions of the present day climate change crisis. So that is what is a unique aspect of Dongriya Khonds.
I'm wearing a Dongriya Khond shawl. What is so specific about this shawl? I know it's about the ecology, but where is the ecology coming? Can you just describe this?
Okay. Dongriya Khond shawls, what they call Kapda Gandha shawl. It's one of their weaving heritage, embroidery heritage. So it's basically, the young girls, when they find their prospective partners, they gift these shawls. So that it's a symbol of love for their prospective partners. So, and you have different kind of symbols in the Dongriya shawls, which represent the cosmology of Neomgiri Mountains. So you have these triangles, for example, are the mountains. Then you have green valley, agriculture fields. Then you have mountain streams. Then you have houses or villages. Then you have... And each color has also, each color also has certain meanings. Like the red, for example, it symbolizes the violence which used to happen, in the Dongriya habitats in the past. Like animal, human sacrifices were happening for...
So do they have a special, like the lepchas in Sikkim and even the Aryan tribes in the Brokpas in Ladakh, they always have oracles and... tree spirits and mountain spirits.
Yes.
So what is the special idea of oracles and, getting attuned to nature and listening to the rhythms of nature?
So they commune with the nature. That's what I have seen, because their priest, before starting, harvesting each crop, or even before starting consumption, like for example, mango crops, mangoes, when they are harvested, before they start consuming, they have to actually offer to their gods. So every...
The hills.
The hills and the hill, then the trees, then you have the mountain streams. Everywhere you have certain kind of gods living. So in each part of the hill even, at the top of the hill, then at the middle of the hill, at the bottom of the hill, everywhere you have specific gods and goddesses residing.
Oh, wonderful.
And before they start constructing a house, before they start living in a village, they have to first take permission of their from their gods.
So as I understand that with the fight with the Vedanta, they were very clear that the mountain, the Neomgiri hill, is their Neomgiri god.
Right.
In terms of animal, which is the, like for the Brokpas, it is the ibex.
What
is the animal for the Dongriya Khonds?
I don't think though there is any specific animal. So, but they do sacrifice animals.
Yes, of course.
That is buffalo.
Buffalo, okay. But in terms of any rituals where they, like, for instance, the nomads of Ladakh, they take particular combination of colored goats to the monastery for blessings, yes. Not for sacrificing because it's Buddhism. They take for blessings. So have you found that are they aligned in bringing some, not for sacrifice, but in creating a centrality of a certain animal, which they, like they have?
No, because they are more or less agriculturalist.
Yeah, okay.
So there is not much of animal association as you find in Ladakh, the nomads. Yeah. Okay. Agro-pastoral numbers.
Yeah.
Here, they are more or less agriculturalists. So their association is more with the plants rather than the animals.
Now, the last question which I want to ask is about sustainable tourism. How do you negotiate? How do you protect the value of these people, their wisdom, their idea of development, their idea of synergizing with the environment, with the false idea that we are coming from outside and therefore we are more developed? How do you sustain this? What are you doing about it? How does the government, how do you think the government should move forward in creating sustainable indigenous or tribal tourism?
Yeah, first of all, Dongariakon, the Niyamgiri is not open to tourists, especially the foreign tourists, since the time Vedanta case has started. So they are prohibited, the foreign tourists. Only they go on Wednesday morning, from the nearest town called Raigada, where there is a weekly haat. So where they get chance to meet these Dongariya people. Women from the mountains, they descend down with their agriculture produces to sell in the haat. So that is how it is happening. Whereas even for Indians, you cannot go in large groups. Only those who have specific interest in sustainable tourism, they are knowledge seekers, they are only allowed. You cannot just go for fun, just to take selfie with the women group, while they are performing dance. So those things are not there. And we don't recommend also to go for the mass tourism, the popular tourism, like what is happening in the other part of the state or elsewhere in the country. So we are not in favor of that. Only with people, yeah. Only those who have specific interests and they want to learn the Dongariya lifestyle, their agriculture.
Your voice is a little so low. Your voice.
Yeah. Can you hear now?
Yeah.
So we are only recommending people, the travelers who have got specific interest in sustainable tourism, understanding about their lifestyle, agricultural practices, the indigenous belief systems, they only can go. And there are no staying options there at present. And
so
So
they go for the day and they come back and they stay in Raipada.
Right, right.
Now, the last question which I want to ask you very specifically is apart from the lesson that you told us about your amazing idea of the Vedanta and how this indigenous community has stood up to this mining giant, any other anecdote to do with the women and the men that you observed was a rather interesting ritual?
I find them are as very generous, very warm people, the Dongariyas. So they are among the excellent people I have seen so far in Odisha. Very, very nice people, very warm, welcoming people. And when you meet them, you forget everything of your stress. So you get, and it's very unconditional.
Do they have fascinating folk tales?
They have a lot of stories to share. But unfortunately, the younger generation, they do not know because of so many factors like, the impact of school education, then modernizations and globalizations and all sort of things. They are now slightly detached from their cultural roots and the folklores and all. But if you start talking to the older folk, especially the young, older ladies and the older men, so they tell you about their origin myth. They tell you about, their origin myth and their association with the mountains, different, and you can easily spend times there, talking to them in a very, very relaxed way and unconditionally. So that is what I find is very, very fascinating, these people.
There is, for instance, now a platform. It's called Folklog and it's being supported by the British Council, where they're documenting folk tales and, you know, tales. Okay. And I think, you know, this will be also a great synergy between your organization and an organization like Folklore, where you prop up the wisdom that comes with these tales, because a lot of these tales is also preservation of ecology.
Right.
I'm interested to know that in the run of Kutch after the earthquake, you know, the rebuilding of the bungas or the traditional houses that happened, unfortunately brought in cement. You know, the idea of development, bringing in cement. I'm sure the same thing is happening in terms of development in these areas as well. Don't you think that a post-COVID, this is something that we should all work towards when you're creating sustainability, homestays, cuisine, and so many other factors, and factoring them into a holistic experience of cultural tourism, that they be a part of, you know, and they have these special facilities of homestays, etc., with toilets and basic facilities. Don't you think that that kind of balance can be attained and should be attained?
Yeah, I think it's a very pertinent question, and this must be done. And we are in the process of adopting one or two villages to start an experiment. You know, on a pilot basis, we are adopting one or two villages. And the nearby, there is another community called Kutiyakons, where we have been working more compared to Dongriyakons. They're the cousin community, you know, the Kutiyakons. And we have already created a small facility for travelers, as a travelers lodge, which was actually NGO. And with certain investment, we have made it habitable now for people who are coming and seeking experience. So that we have done so far. And probably we'll be opening it up once the things once the situation becomes slightly normal, we'll open it up. And then over a period of time, we will actually try to influence more and more people, creating the local leaderships, you know, and understanding that why sustainable tourism is important and how it can change the way you live, not the way you live, but also maintaining your lifestyle intact, and also educate people who are coming from others like us. So that is what we are trying to do.
Thank you, Mr. Jitu Mishra, because it's been an enlightening interaction with you. And what we are hoping to do through this platform of Indian Cultural Heritage Research is bringing these thought-provoking interactions to revisit the idea of sustainable tourism, and not just tourism driven by profits with the, as in bulldozing the natural cultural territories, which should be inherited rather than ruptured territories, sustained territories for the future generations. Thank you so much. And if, before we sign off, could you show us a couple of pictures that are evocative of the Dongriyakons?
So this is like one of their...
Please, could you raise it a little higher? Higher. Okay.
So okay. This is one. And then you have these communities. You can see.
Okay, little far, sir. Yeah. Okay.
So they are performing
fertility dances, right?
Yeah. Okay. So, and this is a typical Dongariya girl.
Oh, how lovely.
So
they seem to have these hair clips, which they are very fond of.
Yes.
Okay.
And bun hair.
Yes.
So these are
how fancy are these bun hairs? And actually, you know, they are the original citizens of India. Yes. We are not. We are genetic cocktails.
Yes, right.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And namaskar from the Indian Cultural Heritage Research. Thank you for accepting our invitation for a talk.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Bye.